Hey, is this on?
Yes.
Hi, good morning. Thank you, Diana. It's great to be here. I'm Maaike with Tacx in the Netherlands. So we're the first panel of this conference. We're all very excited. Today we want to talk to you about using email marketing in the customer journey. And I have my panelists here. Can you please briefly introduce yourself?
Sure. My name is John Feenstra. I'm a channel manager for Otravel. I have over 10 years of experience in email marketing right now. I used to work for agencies for about 8 years, and I decided to switch to customer side. Otravel, you probably don't know. It stands for Online Travel Organization, and we are selling airline tickets, package holidays, all over Europe and South America, Argentina and Uruguay. We have about 10 different labels, and I'm responsible for email marketing for all of those labels, which is a pretty nice job.
Hi everyone, I'm Mistry, Kotecha, and I work for Kotecha before, and I do potential marketing there. My role is very much around marketing, potential in my journey, and also very much in sense communications.
Hi, and I'm Emily from Sveskana. I've been there for like 4 years. And I currently look after our EMEA and Americas region strategies for email marketing, push notifications, and any kind of re-engagement channels.
Thank you, guys. We're going to jump right in. We can define different phases in customer journey. And how do you decide which one to look at? Where do you start?
Should I start? Well, actually, for all our brands, for Otravel, email is our main channel to communicate with our customers because we are completely online focused. So all our contact with our customers is by email, and depends on if someone booked or if someone already is on holiday, we are sending out a lot of emails. So in the customer journey, we will send out emails before booking. For example, if someone didn't book or did book, if someone did book a holiday, we send out a lot of different cross-sell emails to sell a lot of, well, we don't earn a lot of money on airline tickets, so we really need to sell up like a car rental, hotel booking, insurances, all these kind of products, and we try to sell it with our cross-sell program. Which is a very important part of the customer journey. And after, when someone is back on holiday, we are sending out welcome back emails. We're trying to sell photo albums. We're trying to sell them food. Like if you're back from holiday, we know exactly how late you will be back at the airport. So we are giving them discount vouchers for food delivery, for example. So with all those little kind of corporations with external companies, we try to make a lot of benefits for it. And with all our customer data, click data, etc., we try to make our customers rebook again with us. So, that's a pretty long answer, but it depends on if you have booked a holiday, where you go on your holiday.
It's really about looking for the touch points, like what's relevant.
Yeah.
Do you guys have anything to say?
Yeah, so I guess maybe not to everyone in this room, but travel in general is a very low frequency product for most people. You're maybe only booking travel once or twice a year. So when we were developing our email strategy, we realized it was just as important to sort of tap into those non-booking stages, so the inspiration, the dreaming phase, so that when a person is ready to book their travel, like Skyscanner said, front of mind, we then sort of try to go for like a more holistic view. So once you're in that more high intent purchase stage, we've got different emails like the price alerts emails, where if you sign up, they'll tell you if your flight price is going up or it's going down. And then really what's been a big focus for us in the last 6 months is fleshing out that post-booking phase. So if you have our app, you can add your flight home details and we'll give you push notifications for what gate your flight's departing from, whether it's delayed. And then coming in this summer, we're going to start releasing that post-booking part of your phase of your trip. So writing reviews about what your experience was of your travel, which then leads into being the inspiration for the new people, and so you end up with that full customer journey within travel. So even though travel itself is maybe low frequency for the majority of people, Skyscanner can fulfill your needs at every point, and we try to integrate email into every part of that.
And from Kotecha Global, financial services is not as exciting because of all that travel. So we're still building the customer journey and trying to find the optimal amount, but what we've kind of done is we've got our sales, well, see the quote emails, the vendor basket emails, and renewal emails. So we've got the key touch points there, but it's just building on what we've already got and using our data to drive that. So that's what we're going to do over the next 6 months.
Do you have any examples of like how you've developed a lead to customer?
We don't currently, so like everyone just comes to our websites and if they purchase and they opt into marketing, then they'll receive like newsletters from us and emails, etc. But that's something that we're working on to increase it. Because we're a specialist insurance provider, we are highly targeted. There's only a certain group of people who will want to catch insurance, for example.
How about Skyscanner? Do you have any examples of how you work with leads that you come into your database?
So we've actually just changed our opt-in strategy. So previously you could just enter an email address and you would get marketing messages from us. We've actually changed that now so that you can only subscribe to our emails if you create an account with us. So even if it's a higher barrier to entry, the information we'll get will be a lot more rich and hopefully give like a more personalized, valuable experience. I guess if we're thinking about it from like prospects to lead, we do have emails that we call sort of smart flight search emails, and based on your searching behavior, we will then send an email based on that. It's a bit more complicated than just we search Gatwick to Barcelona. If you search, say, Gatwick to Barcelona and then Heathrow to Milan or to a bunch of different destinations, that email will be completely different to one person, to someone that's got a single route in mind. So by using that behavioural, we then sort of highlight different parts of the product to hopefully try and get them to convert within Skyscanner.
Right. I was wondering, do you have any examples that you can share with us how you can create upsell within the customer journey?
Yeah, I'm working for a travel company for about 2 years now, and of course, like everybody in this room, we book airline tickets. We are going on holiday, and I was always really frustrated when companies were sending me emails with only cross-sell products in it, because I had the feeling they only want to have my money, actually. So I want to to make a difference with that. So all our cross-sell emails, they are not only commercial, but they are also with a lot of content in it. So we wrote about, thousands of blogs about our destinations. So people can also read information about the destination where they are going. So the email is not boring, because we only sell insurances, which is quite a boring product next to your holiday. I'm sorry for that.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. So we try to make the email more, sexy actually. So people have the feeling that we care about them and that we send them information which is really relevant, and I can see in the results that the opening rates are better since we are using that kind of content, such also as package lists. We are selling products like excursions. When you go to Barcelona, we are telling our customers, like, maybe you would like to go to the Sagrada Familia, you can order tickets already here. And, Well, that's helping us with selling also other products, because when you're reading about Barcelona or the Sagrada Familia or the best restaurants you can eat, you will also find information about car rental and information about all kinds of different products. We actually earn a lot of money. Well, that's working. I hope that was an answer to your question.
Yeah, definitely. And it actually leads up very well to my next question, because that makes me wonder, how do you know what's relevant for your customers? Of course, logically, we can decide that if you're traveling, you will need a hotel and you might need insurance. So how do you learn what the customer journey really is in that case?
Yeah, that's a pretty good question, actually. I was talking about cross-sell emails, and cross-sell emails we are sending out to our customers, and we know everything about our customers. So we know where, which destination they will go to, when they will go to, with how many people, which age they are, if they booked with us before, all these kind of things. But we also have a lot of customer touch points or touch points with our customers where we don't know who they are. So when someone is subscribing for a newsletter, for example, we are asking them for some preferences. So which continent you would like to go to, which kind of holiday are you interested in? Is it adult only, is it with kids, is it a faraway destination, those kind of things. But it's pretty hard to use those different sources, because we have preferences. We have historical book data. We have book data, from bookings which still have to come. We have click data. We collect also happiness data. In every email we send out, we integrate a feedback form. So we are actually asking, like, how was your experience with your booking? Or how was your holiday? Or what do you think about this email? And our biggest experience to use the data is to actually combine the different data sources. But we are working on that, and we're working actually pretty pragmatic. So we just start and
learn as you go.
Learn as you go, and don't be afraid to make any mistakes. Because when we make mistakes, we will hear from our customers and we will optimize our customer journey.
So how do you guys deal with that?
So I guess when we're trying to send out relevant communications, there's actually, I think Jess the slide earlier sort of explained it the best, that three overlapping Venn diagram. At Skyscanner, we've spent maybe the last 3 years building what we've called a state machine. And it tracks, I mean, it's kind of creepy when you look into it, but we have like a lot of contextualized user data in there, as well as what they've been doing on site, so you can really get a holistic picture of what this person's incentives are, how they've previously been performing on site, and it's obviously way more complicated than anything that I can speak about in great detail, but we then pull out certain attributes and events from that to then create the dynamic placeholders within our emails. So often what we will do is we create, say, one email, it's largely dynamic placeholders, and then we just set it live for like whatever locales we need it to, which again is like a really great way to sort of, yes, maintain that relevancy, but it takes a lot of like the legwork out for the marketers and it helps us be able to deliver our emails at scale as well.
Yes. Now we've got the touch points, we know we want to send emails, and we have the data. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but you, as I said, only sent one-on-one.
Yes, starting to. So we obviously have a lot of our legacy newsletter, which I do my job right, well, hopefully be dead at some point, that goes out sort of every 7 days, but we're building these new emails now. If anyone subscribes, you might have started noticing them come through. We call them smart emails, and all of them are done purely on a one-to-one basis, so there's no sort of like segmentation in terms of like, this is a solo traveler, this is a family, this is, you know, a business traveler. That actually doesn't make sense, because think of your own life, you know, you're here in Barcelona for work, but actually, you know, if you came to Barcelona last year for a grad degree, your booking process would be totally different and your searching behavior would be totally different. We have many different hats in our lives, so it makes no sense to sort of have these categorizations. So all our segmentation and marketing now, yes, there's contextual in terms of making sure we send, you know, it to you in the right language or in the right time zone, but it's purely action based on what's happened on our site. So it's a pure one-to-one customization and segmentation approach.
How do you take care of segmentation within the customer journey?
We've got quite a high level segmentation, so our ideal customer gets sent out emails, but the challenge is going from financial services, no one wants to hear about insurance, and there's a point of doing one, for example. So I guess what we've done in kind of look at is we've taken out our ideal policies now. So we don't have ideal policies, we only have monthly policies, and that makes it easier for customers when it comes to renewing, because they're renewing every month, but every year, so that helps us in terms of our sales as well. And it's just splitting the data and trying to find trends. Because we've got data challenges, it's working what we've got to benefit us in trying to find different hypotheses.
Talking about some more examples that we can discuss here in customer journeys, how do you deal with, for example, with retention? That's a completely different customer journey than what, like, for new customers and leads. Do you have any examples to share?
I don't have any examples currently, but we're looking, for example, to delight customers when customers come to renewal. So how can they keep saying this, or what outline can we put that to them? And then also we're going to have a look at, for example, a referral program that's more beneficial. So we used to have an Amazon referral program, which we can get £10 Amazon vouchers if you refer and referee. But we saw the results decrease over time unless it wasn't promoted. So we're now looking into how we can include that as part of our renewal journey, and customers renew to include that referral program in there to make it more lucrative and more beneficial to the customers. A customer who is referred is more valuable than getting that position.
So for retention is quite interesting problem, and before I moved into email, it's something that I spent a lot of time at Skyscanner trying to like nail the data for, and honestly gives me so many headaches. But for email and trying to bring people in, I think when you're coming up with your re-engagement strategy, be it with email or any other kind of channel, it's all about identifying what is the value in your product, why should someone be using this product, and what have they not tapped into currently that you can offer them. So an example for us would be, someone's booked a flight, okay, let's let them know that they can add their like loyalty card details into their Skyscanner account. Let them know that they can add their passport details in so that when they go to book again, it's a more seamless transaction. There's other touch points that I could bore you with, but I think the main thing about retention is continually messaging at the right time, the right value within your product, so it makes it more sticky and it keeps them in that loop. We're sort of fortunate that we're constantly developing new features, so it's easy to sort of like highlight those and bring them in at the right points, but it does tie into that relevancy. And you know, the best email in the world is not going to increase your retention if your product isn't inherently sort of sticky or, you know, easily retainable. So showing the right value at the right time, I would say, is our key.
I agree. What I would like to add is, of course, we're sending out event shopping cart emails. Conversion rate is pretty high. For our package holidays, we are sending out a repeat email. It's a repeat campaign. So when someone booked a holiday, for example, to Crete in Greece, we are trying to sell them almost the same or the same holiday 1 year later. And I was actually surprised by the results because they were pretty high. We had about 7 or 8% conversion. which tells us that people are really into the same holiday again. So a lot of our customers, I'm not like that, so that's why I was a little bit surprised. They would like to go to the same holiday, to the same place, having dinner in the same restaurant probably, again and again and again. So yeah, we are trying to sell those kinds of holidays again, like the same, and we also make like a comparison tool. When you have been to Greece, we are trying to sell on holiday, for example, to Turkey and to Spain and Portugal for the same same price, for example, between 700 and 1,000 euros. And the conversion is pretty high there as well, so people like to be surprised, but mostly people like to go to the same place again.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You're tapping a little bit into results. Developing customer journeys, what has it brought you? Like, why was it valuable for your business?
Well, I started 2.5 years ago when I was working with Travo. They were just sending out emails once a month, maybe, or maybe once 2 months. There was not a frequency for that. With MailChimp to 10,000 to 20,000 email addresses. So there was a lot of work for me to do. There was no conversion, there was no loyalty at all for email. So in the last couple of years, I set up all those automated customer journeys. Of course, because I don't have time to make up the emails myself every time. So we must make automations, and we want to build up a relationship with our customers. As I mentioned before, we are an online company, so email is actually, we don't have a mobile app, so email is our first touch point with our customers, with our booked customers. We try to make a relationship, a good relationship with our customers, and that's the reason why we set up a lot of customer journeys, and also to make them rebook with us again.
And how has the response been moving to 2.5 years ago? You say just like batch and blast emails, now to more developing customer journeys and being more personalized, getting people to be more loyal. How can you tell that's beneficial?
That it's working, actually. Well, I don't have results from the past, so it's pretty hard to compare those kind of results. But what I can see is that our database has been growing from 10,000 to, 300,000, 400,000 for one brand. I'm talking about Kansi Discounter, which is one of our brands. And we don't have a lot of unsubscribers. So in the past, I think it was 0.7%, and now we have 0.02% unsubscription. Rate, which is pretty low, because actually all emails we are sending out are commercial. We try to sell something, holidays or other products. And we are, I see that the conversion of our products we are also selling next to our airline tickets or package deals, they are increasing, and the results are getting better. But it's pretty hard to give results about our emails, because every email is different. Last week I was at the email summit in Amsterdam, and they were presenting like the results of email in general in the Netherlands. And they say, well, we do pretty good because the average open rate is 30%. But I mean, it really depends on what you're sending out. We have 50 automated campaigns, and every email is different for every person. So how can you say that the average open rate is 30%? It depends on what you're sending out. But the results are getting better, and we are optimizing and testing.
Yeah, but I mean, you've talked about unsubscribe ratings is down. That's a good signal. Your base is growing. So I mean, those are the basic results that you're looking for to see that customer journey is working.
Yeah, and we can see that we have a lot of conversion directly from email. Before, all our conversion was actually by the paid channels. Of course, we had a lot of money to pay to Google, to be on first place.
Everyone wants to be in first place.
Of course, yeah. we'll see that now we can communicate directly with our customers. The costs of email, they are really low compared to other channels, or compared to the paid channels, for example. The investment it's good.
How about you? What has customer journey brought for the business?
So we have one customer journey for the whole company. So, like, and this is slightly off topic for email, but you know, when we're working in sort of our mindset, which is growth marketing, I never work in like just email marketing. I think I probably work across 5 different teams at any one point, anything from like data scientists, the identity, to our content teams. So having that one united customer journey is like really beneficial at like that sort of company level, because it really like it's starting to break down silos. So you're like, oh, I know that person's working on that contact. And so that sharing of knowledge with different disciplines is actually making our emails better, because we've got a greater understanding of what's happening within the product. We've got a great understanding of what's happening with our new content product that's coming this summer. Actually, you can see it live right now if you want to check it out. But, so that's like one benefit. The other benefit is just when you were talking about comparing results. So I was talking about our horrific weekly newsletter that goes out every 7th day. And if I compare the engagement rates on those emails compared to the smart emails I was talking about that are action based, we're pretty much seeing at least 100% uplift on open rate, click through rate, and like click to open rate. So, and that's the minimum. I'm pretty sure like our open rates are quite a bit higher, and our click through rates as well. So, the proof is in the pudding, and it's just getting a case of scaling like more of those types of action based emails, so we can hopefully get the, I'm going to widen the funnel as well. but yeah, it's been pretty great across all of these.
From our services, we are trying to regularly communicate with the customer, build a relationship. So for example, I started supporting social media and competitions where everyone promoting it to our opt-in base, for example. And it's just trying to find using the data to drive our communications. So for example, if a customer only has one catch insured with us, try to identify those customers and see if we can upsell them a bundle of catch insurance. And that also follows through when it comes to renewals, etc. So it's just trying to find that alternative of when to communicate with them and using the data to drive it.
So again, getting better results is what everyone wants to reach. What is a practical way to get started to work on customer journeys or to develop something?
Just start. Just start. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. That's actually how we work. I'm allowed to make mistakes, which is pretty nice. We will learn from our customers. As I mentioned before, we have a feedback form in our email, and people are giving us feedback, and they are telling us everything. For example, we sometimes just ask our customers, what do you think about this email? And they are replying with, well, the food in the restaurant, it was not warm enough, and I didn't like my bed. They tell us everything, and not everything we can use. But you can use from your customers. Just start communicating with them, start listening, and start setting up your campaigns. That's actually, I think, the best way. Just to start. Don't be afraid to make mistakes, and be pragmatic, and test, always test.
And you say, basically, the feedback that you get from your customer, whichever point, that could be a good starting point to start improving something, and then a customer journey can develop from that. Would you try any work?
Yeah, well, the difficult part here is you have to start somewhere. So I start...
That was exactly my question. Where do you start?
Well, I start with my experience of email marketing and the things I believe in and the things I would like to receive myself, or maybe more important, things I don't want to receive myself. So, how to start? It's based on my feeling and the things I believe in, but that's just a start, and you will learn and develop and optimize during your own business journey for the company.
I guess from my point of view, I try to have a look at where I can add value to those customers, where you can. For example, I work quite closely with our administrators, see where we can support them and how we can add value. And just testing and learning, and not trying to, again, like you said, there's no perfect journey. So it's trying to, as long as you're constantly developing and learning and having those results
in
your business, and
say how successful you've been. Yeah, I think for me, and maybe because I'm quite new to email marketing, it's about starting, like, really digging into your product. Like, I didn't even think about email marketing at the start when you're trying to develop this customer experience. Like, really dig into your product and think, okay, at this point in time, like, what is this person thinking? What are they feeling? What is motivating them right now? Once they've got into your product, okay, how is this product going to be making them feel? Again, the same questions. And again, like, actually post-product, once they've come out the other side. And once you have those understandings of that intention and those micro moments, then you can start developing your communications around, like, serendipity. Like, once you have that full understanding, for me, and I know that not everyone has like the same level of resource, but really actually getting to know customers. Like, I remember we have like a random person off the street comes into our office every week and uses our product, and everyone in the company is invited to watch just to get a sense of what these people are feeling when they're using that product. Because once you understand that emotion and that intention, then you can start to work out what's the right thing that you should be saying to them at that point in time, and that's when you bring email into developing your customer journey. So I would say start with your product.
Thanks for this. To sum up, if you could give one piece of advice to the crowd in a few sentences, what would it be?
Just start. Thank you. And don't be afraid to make mistakes. I have some people working under me, and some of them, they just start with email marketing, and they are a little bit nervous, like sending out the first emails. And mostly I'm quite happy if they make mistakes, because making mistakes is learning new, most of them. So, but to keep it short, just start, and you will learn.
I would have you say so to support your customer journey. I think that's really important, really essential for it to be successful.
A great email won't stain a bad product.
I guess that was a good one to finish this demo.
We can try.
Thank you guys so much. And let's see if we have some questions.
There you go.
Okay. I'm Arun from Cheese Digital, my work. Thanks for being on this session and some of the information you shared. From my perspective, the common theme seems to be now or never you have more data touch points than your customers than ever before. From a travel perspective, sorry, but real time is probably even more important because it changes so quickly when you want to book a flight or ancillary products. What's the biggest challenge you found from a data perspective? Was it actually kind of creating that single marketing view, rather than a single customer view, a single marketing view, or is it then, I've got it all in one place, but how do I easily action it? Right? Because you have it there, but then if you need, I don't know, 2 weeks worth of IT time to create an audience, you missed that moment.
Well, I can say something about that. The biggest experience we have with data is how to combine data. We have a lot of data, and in travel we must be very happy because we got gold in our hands actually. But we have too much gold. And how do you combine, for example, click data with booking data, historical book data, and preference data? That's pretty difficult. for us. And yeah, well, we're working on that. So if someone has experience with that, I would like to talk about it these days.
I think for us, the biggest problem we have with data is getting events that are rich enough. So everything that happens on site, we're really lucky. Like, we have that all joined and that all happens together. And I don't know if any of the other businesses in here are similar, but at Skyscanner, currently, a lot of people redirect to another website, like Expedia, for example, and complete their purchasing on that site. So joining up that data, and we've worked out a few hacks around it to try and make it as accurate as possible. We are getting better coverage of that redirect data, but things that happen if you're sending someone to another site that can cause problems with the device.
Hello, Ulf from Merlin Entertainment. I have a question around, I guess, ownership of customer. So if I go on Skyscanner and I'm going to book a flight there, I book with EasyJet, for example, and I just want to get an understanding of, I would probably assume that I'm an EasyJet customer afterwards, and how do you manage that kind of relationship with the customer? How do you get the data? Because you're just passing through people to somebody else. Similar to, I think, the other people on the panel. How do you deal with that kind of data acquisition? And also, how do you ensure you kind of create a loyalty to your brand rather than the actual brand that you are, that the consumer then purchases from?
Yeah, I think on Skyscanner, I think that we've got a lot of additional functionality that a lot of airline websites don't have, like our price alert feature. And as we start, thanks to GDPR, but as we start fixing everything that got broken from a profile perspective, that'll come back even stronger. Then you're not tied to EasyJet, you're not tied to that airline. They don't cover every route in the world, and so with that, Skyscanner will give you an additional value that you won't get from even specific airline. And I find the other part of your question quite interesting, which is managing that customer relationship, are they with Skyscanner, are they with EasyJet? Because it is something, we get emails every day from travellers saying, I booked with you, now you cancelled my flight. I'm like, no, you didn't. And I think that's going to, as our product evolves, where we start having branded checkout within the Skyscanner platform, that relationship is going to become more challenging to manage, simply because I don't think, except for maybe Tmall, I don't know if anyone knows, but I don't think there's really another website that facilitates that. So that'll be a job for us in terms of messaging and making sure that branded experience is sort of managed correctly.
Okay, please respond.
Well, I think we don't segment yet based on airline. For example, if you book an airline flight with EasyJet, we don't target you as an EasyJet customer. But we are actually make segmentation based on destinations and based on the price you are willing to pay. So if you book a flight with EasyJet, you probably also would make flights with Ryanair, for example. So we segment on that, but not on the other list.
Yeah. There seems to be quite a few questions around data. I've got another one, I'm afraid. Specifically, you were talking about using site data, behavioural data from your site. How much data do you actually end up being able to use as people use so many different devices and companies like Apple are locking cookies and stuff with iOS 11?
Yeah, so we are extremely fortunate. So we've built our own data center in-house and it's joined. It is fully joined. I think we kids basically to sort of join that cross device situation. However, it is extremely difficult because segmenting by device and to recognize that it's the same person, say if you've got an Android phone and an iPad or an iPhone and iPad. Unless you're logged in on both the devices, it is completely impossible. And I agree with you, and that's why we're moving towards this absolute drive to get account creation and login. Quite foolishly, it's best kind of, we didn't focus on it that much, but it's a massive goal for us for H2 to try and overcome those, to overcome that area. And the way that we're planning to do that is, so one of our like mantras is traveler first. So I don't want to sort of be telling people to log in just because I get the data that I need. And it's about making sure that we have really valuable propositions behind account creation to then give value to the traveler whilst also serving our needs. So that sometimes you just need the person to do the action, and there's no magic bullet, I don't think, for the device.
One more question?
Yeah.
Oh, you know.
Hi, I'm Thomas from Swisscom. You quickly touched on it. If there is an issue with the trip, the baggage got lost or the flights got cancelled, and it's obviously the airline's responsibility, but people are still mad at you eventually.
Yeah.
Do you have any strategies in place whereas, okay, we have a customer support ticket on that person, so we're not sending emails during that period or for 6 months or whatever. What's your strategy? When a customer is not happy, whether it be your fault or not, do you exclude him from marketing activities or not?
Yeah, so currently we actually, we have been going to refund flights that were not purchased through us just because the customer is so distressed that they have booked with one of our partners. So I guess now there is a certain level of responsibility. So actually currently right now, it's not generally airlines that are the worst, online travel agents, that's because sometimes we're a bit dodgy. And we do refund flights on their behalf from time to time. However, we're gonna start trying to get more clever about this. We have one of our pillars for our strategy going ahead is one called disruptive customer care. And with this sort of branded shopping experience, you know, we were discussing the other day with our CEO, and he sort of said, my dream is that you're on a flight, you've missed your connection, Skyscanner's already, by the time you land, Skyscanner's already booked you a hotel and the flight the next day. So that is sort of our plan to get to at some point. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, so if anybody else has any more questions, Maaike's going to be heading a roundtable on the same subject after, just before lunch, but let's give these guys a round of applause.